The next item on the agenda is a presentation by CNSC staff on the bystander effect in radiation biology and its relevance to radiation protection in uranium mines and mills, as outlined in CMD 16M14 and 16M14.A. And I understand that Dr. Thompson will try to take us through this. Over to you.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Donc, je vais le faire avec en équipe, c'est beaucoup plus facile. Donc, bonsoir, Monsieur le Président, Madame et Messieurs les commissaires. Mon nom est Patty Thompson. Je suis conseillère scientifique à la Direction générale du soutien technique. I'm accompanied by Mr. Alan DeSautoy, Director of the Radiation and Health Sciences Division, and by Ms. Julie Burt, a Radiation and Health Sciences Officer in that division. We are here today to present CMD 16M14 in response to a request from the Commission following the public meeting held in October 2014. As a result of intervener comments, the Commission sought further information on the relevance of the bystander effect to radiation protection of uranium mine and mill workers. The CMD provides an overview of the state of the science on bystander effects and other closely related non-targeted effects of radiation, their potential impact on the dose-response relationship between radiation exposure and cancer incidence, and finally, their significance for radiation protection of workers and members of the public. I will ask Ms. Burt to make the staff's presentation.
Thank you, Dr. Thompson. My name is Julie Burt. As mentioned, I am a radiation and health sciences officer with expertise in the exciting field of radiation biology. Before we begin, I'd like to take the time to highlight the main international agencies who contribute to the radiation protection regulatory framework, as I will be discussing their role and scientific position on certain matters throughout today's presentation. First off, the United Nations Scientific Committee on the Effects of Atomic Radiation, or UNSCEAR, provides the scientific basis for the radiation safety regime. Secondly, the International Commission on Radiological Protection, or ICRP, takes the information from UNSCEAR, the international scientific literature, and socioeconomic factors, and provides protection philosophy, principles, and units. We often refer to these collectively as the ICRP recommendations. Next, the International Atomic Energy Agency, or IAEA, develops safety standards and protection programs for member states to adopt. Finally, the Canadian Nuclear Safety Commission, or CNSC, uses all of this information to develop Canada's regulatory framework, which is based on the best available science. Perhaps the most critical part of this figure is that CNSC staff provide expertise to all of these international agencies, whether it be from staff serving as delegates, sitting on working groups, or providing comments on draft publications. CNSC staff are very involved when it comes to shaping the international regulatory framework. Furthermore, the CNSC can deviate from international guidance and recommendations to ensure Canada's best interests are being met. Similarly, other countries have developed their framework based on what is best for their country. Historically, the best available science has taught us that according to the classic target theory of ionizing radiation, deleterious effects such as mutations or cancer are attributed to radiation damage to a cellular target, usually identified as nuclear DNA. This occurs due to the direct absorption of radiation energy, the consequences of which are expressed in the surviving irradiated cells. The image on the left shows ionizing radiation passing through the nucleus of one cell, and only damaging that nucleus. The image on the right shows a normal cell being hit by radiation, creating a mutation. That same mutation is passed on to progeny, or daughter cells, after each cell division. These two images are both demonstrating the targeted effects of radiation. However, most of the time when radiation causes damage, the cell dies or is repaired. Very rarely, the cell is not repaired properly and possibly leads to a mutation. It's important to note that not all mutations lead to the development of a cancer. In fact, it takes on the order of 20 mutations before a cancer develops. Based on this understanding of how radiation behaves and affects cells, a dose-response model was developed to describe how the risk of cancer varies with radiation dose. A dose-response model is a theoretical model that has been established from what we know about the targeted effects of radiation in populations with moderate exposures. A dose-response model is not intended to calculate individual risk of developing cancer from radiation exposure. An assessment of individual risk requires information on a person's radiation dose, the dose rate, that person's age and sex, as well as other lifestyle, genetic, and environmental factors that could impact their total risk. Despite this information, cancer, if it occurs in an individual, cannot unequivocally be attributed to radiation exposure because radiation exposure is not the only possible cause, and there are no generally available biomarkers that are specific to radiation-induced health effects. The graph on this slide shows the different types of radiation dose response models, where the risk of cancer, which is on the y-axis, increases with increasing absorbed dose, which is on the x-axis. The x and y-axis meet at the baseline risk of a health effect. So everything shown on this graph is on top of the natural risk level of developing cancer. In Canada, the baseline risk of developing cancer is between 40 and 45%. The data points on the graph are shown as open circles with vertical uncertainty bars. These data points come directly from epidemiological studies for which sound data becomes available at approximately 100 millisieverts. Error bars for each data point demonstrate the wide range of data used to establish the average data point. The lowest dose at which excess cancers, or cancers caused by radiation and not some other factor, have been observed in adult populations is approximately 100 millisieverts. The different lines on the graph show possible radiobiological mechanisms acting at low doses. The regulatory dose response model currently used to describe how cancer risk varies with radiation dose is called the linear non-threshold model, or LNT for short, shown here as line B. The LNT model assumes that harmful effects occur in directly hit or targeted cells, and the risk from developing cancer from these effects increases as the dose increases. Most types of cancer follow a linear dose-response relationship at moderate doses. There is also strong scientific evidence for other types of dose-response models. Line A is superlinear. This model suggests that there is a greater risk of developing cancer at lower doses. Line C is linear quadratic. This model suggests that repair mechanisms may be more effective at very low and low doses than at higher doses. For example, this is the model adopted internationally to estimate the risk of leukemia. Line D has a threshold. This model suggests that below a certain dose, there is no risk. For example, this is the case for bone cancer from exposure to radium-226. Line E shows the hormesis model, which suggests that exposures to low doses induces a protective or a beneficial effect. The basis for the LNT model comes from epidemiology and radiation biology studies. The epidemiological studies which have been found to support the LNT model include the atomic bomb survivor studies of the Chernobyl cleanup workers, studies of patients treated with radiotherapy for non-cancer diseases, studies of miners exposed to radon decay products, and studies of nuclear energy workers. The LNT model is a prudent conservative model for regulatory purposes. It is not appropriate for risk determination. Radiation biology studies refer to studies done on cells or animals. They are used to inform dose response models when no sound epidemiological data is available in the low and very low dose region. Both epidemiological and radiation biology studies are reviewed and considered in the development of international reports, like those of UNSCEAR and the ICRP. Next, we will discuss two types of effects of radiation in cells not directly hit by radiation, what are called non-targeted effects. These are important because they do not respond linearly to a dose of radiation. So far in the presentation, we've been talking about the targeted effects of radiation. In the last two decades, the existence of non-targeted effects have been reported in the scientific literature, These effects are radiation-like effects that have been observed in cells that have not been directly hit by radiation. Many different types of non-target effects exist, including the bystander effect, genomic instability, adaptive response, gene expression, low-dose hypersensitivity, and inverse dose rate effects. This presentation will focus on two types, the bystander effect and genomic instability, which I will discuss in detail in the following slides. Non-target effects can be induced by radiation or other stressors, and they are not unique to uranium mines and mills workers. These effects, often referred to as low-dose effects, occur below 1 gray, which is essentially equivalent to 1,000 millisieverts for the purposes of this presentation, and can be induced by different types of radiation, including alpha particles, X-rays, and gamma rays. Radiation-induced bystander effects are defined as biological effects that occur in cells not directly hit by radiation, but rather in cells that are in close proximity to irradiated cells. These biological effects range from chromosome damage to cell death, but the entire list of possible types of damage is quite lengthy. Bystander effects are triggered when only a fraction of the cells present are hit by radiation at doses below about 1 gray. These are moderate to lower doses. At high doses, most of the cells have been directly hit by radiation. In image A, you can see the nucleus of one cell getting hit by radiation. This is illustrated by the blue healthy nucleus turning red. In image B, you can see that the nuclei of many cells have turned pink to illustrate that although they have not been hit by radiation, they have received damage signals from the red nucleus. The bystander effect as a whole depends on the type of radiation, high or low linear energy transfer, meaning densely or sparsely ionizing, the dose and the dose rate, and the time of analysis after exposure. Again, repair and other mechanisms will ensure that the probability of a cell becoming carcinogenic is extremely low. Bystander effects depend on communication between cells. A signal is sent from a directly irradiated cell, shown as the signaling cell in the image above, and is received by a cell that did not receive any radiation, shown as the receptor cell in the image. The receptor cell then triggers a biological response to the signal. The bystander effect is mediated by two main forms of communication, gap junctions and secreted soluble factors into the extracellular space between cells. As seen in the top picture, gap junction signaling occurs when two cells are right next to each other and their cell membranes may actually be touching. A gap junction is a tunnel-like opening that can allow movement of molecules from one cell to another. As seen in the bottom picture, paracrine signaling occurs when the signaling cell sends molecules that can act locally by diffusing inside other cells that are in the close environment. The other non-targeted effect that we are focusing on today is radiation-induced genomic instability. Genomic instability refers to the accumulation of different types of alterations or changes in the genome being transmitted to progeny or daughter cells. As seen at the top of this figure, the red cell has been directly hit by radiation and the beige cells have not. After cell division, you can see that at different time points, the beige cells are turning different colors, representing different forms of damage. The light blue cell has developed a micronucleus, which is a small structure containing genetic material inside the cytoplasm away from the nucleus. The green cells have developed a mutation. The black cells have died. The large dark blue cell has failed to go through mitosis or cell division. The purple and red cells have suffered changes in the structure or number of chromosomes in the organism. Again, approximately 20 gene mutations are needed before a cell can become carcinogenic. The detailed mechanism behind genomic instability is not fully understood at this time. What is understood is that epigenetics and chronic inflammation play a major role in the perpetuation of genomic instability. Epigenetics are changes in gene expression that take place without physically changing the DNA sequence. An example of this type of change is adding a methyl group, which is a carbon atom bound to three hydrogen atoms, to DNA. Binding this small molecule to DNA has the power to turn gene expression off and effectively stops the gene from doing its job, As part of the immune response, inflammation plays an important role in defending the body against pathogens such as bacteria and viruses. However, inappropriate activation of inflammatory processes is an underlying contributor to many common diseases, including playing a role in tumor proliferation and metastasis. An example of this type of response is the ability of inflammatory mediators, like reactive oxygen species, also called free radicals, to destabilize the genome by inducing DNA damage or affecting DNA repair systems, or even altering the cell cycle. If we pause here to recap, the difference between targeted and non-targeted effects can be shown nicely by putting these two images side by side. Targeted effects of radiation are where the progeny cells contain the same mutation as the parent cell, as shown on the left. And non-targeted effects of radiation are where the progeny cells display different types of damage, which were not expressed in the parent cell, as shown on the right. The reason non-targeted effects are important is because they do not follow a linear dose response curve. It is not known with certainty whether non-targeted effects are harmful or beneficial. The studies concluding that non-targeted effects could decrease cancer risk are observing high levels of apoptosis, or cell death, as shown in black on this figure. A high level of apoptosis results in radiation-induced damage, like mutations, not being perpetuated during cell division. On the other hand, the studies concluding that non-targeted effects could increase cancer risk are observing an accumulation of genomic instability, shown in pink as the first instability event on this figure. An accumulation of genomic instability could then be passed on to the cell's progeny. It should also be noted again that not all radiobiological effects will lead to cancer. The exact shape of the dose response curve at low and very low doses is not known, and more research is needed to better define the mechanisms of non-targeted effects in plausible scenarios for typical human exposures. UNSCEAR has identified the need to integrate radiobiological and epidemiological research to enhance the understanding of radiation-induced health effects and associated inferred risks related to the induction of cancer, non-cancer effects, and hereditary diseases. The reason why this presentation does not solely focus on the bystander effect and includes genomic instability is because there's new scientific evidence that supports the hypothesis that these two non-targeted effects interact with one another and together may facilitate cancer development, as shown on this slide, which we will go through in a clockwise manner. Excuse me. At the top, in frame A, you can see a cell nucleus being directly hit by radiation, shown by a red nucleus. On the right, in frame B, healthy blue nuclei have turned pink to show that they have received damage signals from the red nucleus. Reactive oxygen species are considered to be one of the main molecules in the chain of events that leads to the propagation of the bystander effect. If one of the affected bystander cells undergoes cell division, as shown on the bottom in frame C, inflammatory mediators could impede DNA repair or cause the cell cycle not to be completed properly, resulting in genomic instability. In other words, the bystander effect can induce genomic instability, as shown on the left in frame D. A possible outcome from frame D is a possible increased cancer risk. Another possibility is that epigenetic regulation is causing a positive feedback loop between frames D and B, where bystander events can cause more genomic instability, or vice versa, where genomic instability is causing more bystander events, all of which have the potential to facilitate cancer development. Bear in mind that, as mentioned previously, throughout these processes, other processes, such as repair, are stopping cells from becoming carcinogenic and acting against cells getting to frame D. This figure is taken from a recent paper published by CNSC staff in the Journal of Radiological Protection. According to the United Nations Scientific Committee on the Effects of Atomic Radiation, the extent to which the bystander effect can modify cancer development is not known, nor has it been established with any certainty whether these effects increase cancer risk by generating more DNA damage in neighboring cells, or decrease cancer risk by defective cells undergoing apoptosis and therefore stopping the perpetuation of DNA damage. Since the publication of this report in 2012, studies have been published in support of both of these hypotheses. Unskier concluded that a gross underestimation of the risk from low and very low doses using various dose response models is very unlikely, because this would have been detected by epidemiological studies. Furthermore, Unskier maintains their view that the LNT is an unproven hypothesis, but recognizes the need for a pragmatic tool for radiation protection purposes. Most countries, including Canada, have adopted the LNT model for radiation protection purposes. Similarly, the International Commission on Radiological Protection is of the opinion that although there are uncertainties at low doses and low dose rates, direct epidemiological measures of radiation-induced cancer risk include the risk from all non-targeted effects. Of note, in ICRP publication 99, the ICRP state that due to uncertainties in the low-dose region, extrapolation from high-dose effects for low-dose exposures may not be justified in all circumstances. The ICRP conclude that the LNT combined with the reduction factor is a prudent approach for radiation protection. A reduction factor accounts for the higher biological effectiveness of high doses at inducing damage when predicting damage due to low doses from simple extrapolation. With the discovery of bystander effects and genomic instability largely occurring in 1992, much work has been done to define the determining characteristics of these non-targeted effects. Current research efforts are aiming to determine to what extent different types of non-targeted effects interact with one another, determine whether non-targeted effects increase or decrease cancer risk, develop more relevant in vivo models and 3D tissue models to accurately portray human exposure scenarios, determine how genetic sensitivity and epigenetic changes induced by high, medium, and low doses of radiation can influence risk, among many other important areas of research. Throughout the entire presentation, we have been discussing the uncertainty in estimating cancer risk at low and very low doses of radiation. To bring the discussion into a practical setting rather than experiments performed on cells or animals in a laboratory setting, we can look at uranium mines as a good example. Strict control measures are enforced to reduce potential risk to all nuclear energy workers in Canada. In uranium mines, there are modern ventilation systems, strict regulations and standards specific to the type of facility, stringent and well-monitored radiation protection programs, and of course the application of the ALAR principle, which means keeping doses as low as reasonably achievable considering social and economic factors. The ALAR principle is implemented by having management control over work practices, training of personnel, control of occupational and public exposures to radiation, planning for unusual situations, and other measures such as radiological performance targets. The risk to Canadian uranium mines and mills workers has been assessed in several CNSC published reports. In 2014, CNSC staff compiled information on exposures and risks to uranium mines and mills workers since 2000 for the Government of Quebec's Bureau des sciences publiques sur l'environnement, or BAP for short. This report found very low doses, below 0.5 millisieverts per year for every year since 2000. In 2013, levels of radon decay product exposures for uranium miners were almost 1,000 times lower than what they were in the 1940s and 50s. In 2003, the CNSC funded a feasibility study that considered monitored miners to determine whether it was feasible to estimate the risk of developing lung cancer due to low doses of radon decay products. The study found that the risk of lung cancer at these very low radon decay product exposures would be less than 1 in 24,000 above the baseline lung cancer risk. Such low risk would be practically impossible to detect given the lung cancer risk of the general population due to tobacco smoking and residential radon exposure. In today's uranium mines, doses are so low that the risk is extremely low. As a result, any impact non-targeted effects may have on cancer development is impossible to assess in a mine setting, but overall, the risk of lung cancer remains very low. In summary, the current radiation protection framework is adequately protective for members of the public and all workers. As per international guidance, the CNSC regulatory framework uses the LNT model to set dose limits and ELARA requirements. Individual cancer risk is not assessed using the LNT, but rather requires information on a person's radiation exposure, the dose rate, their age and sex, different lifestyle choices, their genetic background, as well as certain environmental factors. At this time, it is not possible to attribute a cancer to low and very low radiation exposures. Non-targeted effects are not impacting the health or safety of members of the public or nuclear energy workers. The shape of the dose response model is not known at low and very low doses. The combination of dose limits and the ELARA principle provides a conservative precautionary approach to radiation protection. For example, at doses below about 100 millisieverts, any impact of non-targeted effects should be minimized with the use of the ELARA principle. And at doses above about 100 millisieverts, any impact of non-targeted effects are captured in epidemiological studies looking at cancer incidence and mortality. In conclusion, CNSC staff will continue to stay apprised of all current science and how it could impact our regulatory framework. I would like now to pass the presentation back to Dr. Thompson.
Thank you, Mr. President, members of the Commission. This ends our presentation, and we're available to answer questions.
Thank you.